the sports world. It's a circus.
Welcome to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal, live from Las Vegas.
You know, score, put the ball down, give it to the referee. You know, and I don't even care if you slam it down, but you don't have to dance. You don't have to call your mom on the phone. You don't have to go hug you.
The Sports Circus is a one-hour, primetime, nationally syndicated program that's carried on ABC, CBS, Fox, NBC News, and CNBC radio affiliates, plus Cox, Comcast, Spectrum, Frontier, WOW cable TV affiliates across North America and nationwide in upscale hotels and resorts on hotel television in all 210 Nielsen-rated markets.
Just like a circus. My life is just a party, and parties weren't meant to last. Dickerson.
Jason Hook, Zarbler from Five Finger Death Punch.
Sidney Justin from The Miracles.
My name is Curtis Blow. Basketball is my favorite sport. I like the way they dribble up and down the court. I'm here on the Sports Circus.
The Sports Circus brings top sports and entertainment content and is delivered fully produced and is easy pass-through traffic for radio stations. Simply drop the program in your traffic manager and the full 59-minute, 50-second file will coordinate with the clock. Your local station receives up to 4 minutes of local avails during the Sports Circus broadcast, and it's a great lead to live sports and entertainment.
Well, if you're going to talk about our congressman being crooked, why not talk about commercial products who don't do what they represent to do?
Yes!
Big Billy here, he certainly knows something about making things difficult on the
God
competition.
He's a punisher.
Yeah, he just broke the ribs. You know, I still haven't broke someone's collarbone yet in a boxing match.
That's a great statement. I have not broke someone's collarbone in the ring yet.
I've never heard that before.
Is there a reason you said in the ring? Is it that you've broken collarbones just outside of the ring?
You did catch that, right? He said in the ring.
Exactly. He got him on the curtain. He got him on the edge of the ring and broke his collarbone.
Hey, this is Tommy John, and you're listening to the Sports Circus.
I had to get Sal's name right.
Well, that never happened.
That's
Sal
Floor Sweeper. That's his new name.
Sal the bookkeeper.
Hey, yeah, but even my name, even my last name.
Add that one to the bank, you know?
But no, Alicia, you even got my last name wrong. That's why I said my name.
I know it starts with a V. It starts with a V.
He said a V. Really? Look, where's the punch sound? 400 punches.
Here's the punch sound.
Right, exactly. Look, he almost knocked out the microphone.
Alicia, that's why they have cue cards, right? That's what that, you know. So don't let the name bother you. Just bring a cue card with you next time.
Yeah, but people can't read my name off a cue card.
Or change your name to Joe Smith or something. Jeez, make it easy.
Yeah. This is Sal Tuzzolino, host and remaster of the Sports Circus. Why listen to the same old dog and pony show that you've heard all day long? The Sports Circus covers everything that other shows don't or are too scared to cover. There's no primetime show like it on air that'll punch you in the mouth. And you'll beg for more. Also, you could call in and participate with our chaos if you dare. Join me and celebrity guests for Havoc and Mayhem. Remember, folks, it's a circus, and we prove it every day.
I want to try to instill some of this winning environment for this particular team. What's been your experience? Kevin, we're going to start with you. What was your experience going from Team A to Team B and bringing that Super Bowl experience to the next team?
You know, they were kind of getting on me, wanting me to chill out a little bit, not play a game on a Wednesday and Thursday. But I always felt that, you know, you got to play at game day speed on Wednesday and Thursday so that you're instinctive and you can play on game day speed on game day.
The Sports Circus is received well on all radio formats and is currently aired on sports, news, and music stations.
Andre Reed.
Mario Andretti.
Herschel Walker.
Roy Firestone.
Mike Hayne.
Tim Jeffcoat.
Rod Jaworski.
Al Bubavich.
Brett Saberhagen.
It's a circus and we prove it every day.
Aaron Fink. Breaking Benjamin.
Jason Hartlett. Drummer for rock legend Ted Nugent.
Matt Starr. Drummer for Ace Frehley from Kiss.
Phil Buckman. The bass player in the rock band Fuel.
Hey, brother.
Hey, we know quality content is hard to find, so if you're ready to have the Sports Circus in your market, give us a call right now at 714-948-0100. That's 714-948-0100. Or email us at info@thesportscircus.com. That's info@thesportscircus.com. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time right here on your favorite station. Until then, so long, everyone. Good morning and welcome to the Sports Circus here in fabulous Las Vegas on Fox Sports 1340. I'm here with the Human Cannonball. My name is Sal, your ringmaster. Human Cannonball, how are you today?
I'm feeling pretty good. It's not raining today. It's cold as heck out there, Vegas style, but it's not raining, so I'm happy.
It's very nice out. And the applause comes in. It's very nice out, and I got to tell you, it never gets old driving here and looking at the strip lights. You know, the city's all lit up. And
I always worry about the strawberries on top of the 1,500 police cars I got to drive through to get over here. I actually saw 3 rollovers and like 9 what? Pullovers.
Wow.
They must make all the money. It's not enough to have like 100 casinos, Sal. They gotta peel every other driver over and give them a $200 ticket.
And
driving over here gives me hives.
And it's not even the end of the month either when they have to get their quota in for the tickets.
That's what I get living in a town that's 50 miles away.
Well, that's okay. Look at it this way. At least this is a very small town. Everything here is, what, 20 minutes away?
Yeah. Doing 65 miles an hour on a nine-lane highway.
You could get from end to end in this valley in 30 minutes. I don't want to hear that garbage.
Well, that's why I got here in 30 minutes.
Right. Looking for the strawberries, right?
Watching out for them.
Right. So this... Today's show is brought to you by the American Business Trust Company. They specialize in helping new companies grow, bring investment capital in, strategy, sales, marketing, etc. They can be reached at 657-600-1876. Also, you can visit them online at www.abtrustco.com. So, Barry, if you're looking to start a new company, get a hold of them. They've been doing it for 25 years. 657-600-1876.
Great. I'm hoping to pay some taxes this year. So, you know, I got companies in my future. So,
well, if you're hoping to pay taxes, that means you probably made some money. That's good news.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, that's how I look at it anyway. So, you know, this, of course, being the Sports Circus, I have to tell you, I don't normally talk about golf. I'm just not a golf guy, but I have to tell you this. This is fun. So there was a golf story that came out a few days ago. It's the Sony Open over in Kapalua in Maui. What a great place. I know the course. This kid, Justin Thomas, shoots a 59. 59!
How do you even do that?
I can't even do that on mini golf.
Is it plausible? Did he do the impossible, Sal?
He damn near did the impossible, and not only that, he did it, and of course, in a really big tournament, you know, and the biggest stage for golf. But he's also done. He hasn't done the same thing, but he 8 times in a row he has shot under 70, which means basically your average course being 72 for your par. I guess it's, you know, averages 4 strokes a hole. Well, this guy has done it 8 times in a row, and that's a PGA record. That's ridiculous.
I think Tiger Woods kind of gave these young kids the permission to play target golf. You know, not like granddad does. You know,
right.
Like, where's the hole, and let's just hit the ball out as hard as we can.
Right, right. Well, the funny thing is, my golfing experience, you're going to laugh about this. I used to live on a golf course, and I think I've played a grand total of 10 times. And the sand trap was right in my backyard, right at the edge of the yard. And the sand trap, of course, a lot of people get caught in there. It's just the way that they had the course designed, of course. See if I can say, of course, a few more times, of course. Anyway, so now you've got these people getting stuck in the sand trap. And here's me opening my kitchen window on purpose and clanging my pots and pans together right when they're on their backswing.
Well, there you go.
Why? Just because I could. But I'll tell you why, really. The times that I had on the golf course really haven't been that great. I mean, I can knock the cover off the ball. I can hit it fairly straight, too. But I got to tell you, hitting a ball 200 yards, chasing it. Hitting a ball 200 yards again, chasing it. It doesn't make a hell of a lot of sense. If you could drink a beer and do it, it's not a sport, in my opinion. I mean, I'm not taking anything away from
fishing's
Justin
a sport.
Thomas.
No offense to all of our anglers out there. But
I love fishing.
Who's had a beer and a rod in their hand, Sal? Sport.
Well,
sorry.
Yeah, that happens in this town quite a bit.
Oh,
so
I wouldn't eat the fish, but you can catch them.
Right. But going back to this golf thing, I think on my second time out, I hit a van. No kidding. I hit a van. I hit it right in the grill. No kidding. It gets worse. I hit a golf cart. I hit a building. Now, this isn't all in the same round.
I was about to say, did the golf marshal come after you?
No, my first round took 8.5 hours. Of course, we got hounded a little bit on that.
Good
And then, right, so I hit a cart, I had a building, I had a van, I had a person. I took my father out one time. It was the only time he and I ever gone. And he said, oh, yeah, I know how to golf. Okay, great, Dad. You know, this is not mini golf. And here I am about on my sixth turn at it. And my father, he goes and no kidding. He loses 27 golf balls on the first hole.
No way.
I swear to you.
You have more patience than I can imagine.
He ran out. He actually ran out of golf balls in the first hole. I'll never forget it. It was ridiculous.
That's like mulligan stew instead of a mulligan. Right?
I don't even know. All I know is I'm like, hey, Dad, you know, it's your turn. It's the second hole. I'm going to let you go first. And sure enough, what happens? He's like, well, I don't have any golf balls. I'm like, well, what do you mean you don't have any golf balls? That's the guy. It was the funniest thing because I thought he was kidding. I mean, who knew?
I can't golf, Sal.
I can't either. I mean, obviously, unless it's you know,
I can't get through
targets.
a bucket of balls at the driving range before I'm like, why am I here?
Right. Well, I had to mention that because I mean, look, this.
Well, that's obviously amazing. I mean, 59, and tell me about this kid again.
I don't know much about him. I don't follow golf.
Neither do I. But I mean, what's his name at least?
Justin Thomas, and he did it in Maui. What a great place!
Justin Thomas in Maui. I mean, you are one heck of a golfer. Hey, check look up for him, folks. I mean, this kid, this individual, he may be 100. I don't know how old he is, but
no, he's a young kid.
This young kid might be the future of golf, and I think Tiger Woods gave him permission. Shoot it at the stick.
I don't
know, man.
That's
the new rules.
But he's already on the tour, and he's already killing it, I guess. So,
God bless.
You know, when you see stuff like that, you don't really know what to say other than holy crap. It's like getting a free set of headphones in your head when you didn't bring your headphones, right? It's one of those deals.
Hey, headphones are good to hear with.
Right, right. So, switching to the world of boxing.
Oh, wow. Is it boxing anymore? Let's be honest.
Right, I know. But we have to talk about this because Floyd Mayweather, of course, being here in town.
Money Mayweather.
Yeah, right, right. call him what you will. But I'd like to see him grow up here and fight McGregor because now he says the only thing that's going to hold him back from the fight is McGregor.
It's so confusing and baffling, and I remember listening like all the other people. I'd get on the sports radio on the way home, and I'd go, oh, my God, he's going to fight Pacquiao. Is he 49-0 in his legacy? And now all of a sudden this guy will risk his own legacy.
Oh, it's just a money grab. Get out of here.
Yeah, but I think, again, I'm wrong all the time. Everybody knows that. Sal, give it to him. Sal was 6-1. Sal won. Sal picked Clemson. Sal won
out. I had the total off by one. It was ridiculous.
Sal, you lost one game by 1 point, and I had a half a point, okay? And I give it up to you. But I'm still going to stand out and say, Conor McGregor beat the crap out of Floyd Mayweather.
I hope so. I'd love to see it.
Why is he offering up his legacy? Why is 49-0 for sale for $50 million plus some juice?
Oh, no. It's going to be $100 million plus most of the purse from pay-per-view. But wait a minute. Remember, this isn't even
you gotta
in
need
the octagon.
Money. You got to need the money. You have to.
Well, see, the boxing ring gives Mayweather a chance to run around and run away from this guy because if he gets hit by a wrecking ball left or right by McGregor, it's all over, buddy.
I was wrong with Alabama. I don't think I'm going to be wrong with McGregor. I can't be wrong all the time.
No. I mean, a stop clock gets it right twice a day.
True that.
Right? But there's no way McGregor is going to get knocked out. And the only way that Mayweather would win that fight is if he runs away from McGregor the entire match.
I think the only way he wins is if McGregor forgets that it's a boxing match and throws kicks him in the face.
Right. I can't say it any other way either. Look, I would love to see the fight happen. I think most of the boxing and MMA world would love to see it just because, all right, great, you've got this 49-0 guy. Let's just see how good you are because the real champion of champions – and it's not the guy behind you on that picture right there, Muhammad Ali. The real champion of champions in the boxing world is Rocky Marciano.
Wow.
That's the guy.
You got bodyguards when you walk out of here, man. That's Ali you're looking at.
I don't care. That's Lou. Whatever. Look, Cassius Clay is Cassius Clay.
God bless you.
But guess what? When it comes to undefeated 61-0, who is it? Rocky Marciano.
I'm sure you're right, Sal. You obviously you're right all the time.
No, so I'm not
listen,
right
everybody.
All the time.
If you can
hell
get a
no.
bet on it, go find a wager, and no. That's the winner.
If I was right all the time, I wouldn't be sitting here. Are you kidding? I'd be
most of the time
sitting back at a beach.
Yeah, I'm a big guy,
margaritas.
So the shirts that say fit most people, it's not true. That's a big lie.
Yeah, well, you're wearing Mickey Mouse again. You know, most people don't wear
it's
that.
It's 4X, Sal. It fits.
4X. 4X. And they have one of those burgers at the Heart Attack Cafe downtown.
I don't qualify. I'm 297 pounds. I mean, it's effing. I got to put rocks in my pocket to get this free burger.
I think all you got to do is go to the buffet, go hammer down 400 plates of prime rib, and then go over there. Boom. You got it. You have plenty of
Wicked
weight on
spoon.
You.
Wicked Spoon. I'm going to give it to them. I kill that place. They cannot make money on me. Wicked Spoon.
I've never been there.
It's at the Cosmopolitan. It's awesome.
Oh, well, that's the high-rent district, amigo. I don't know. I can't really go there right now.
You spend $28, you leave with $128 worth of dim sum in your belly.
Oh, that's good stuff. Love dim sum. Nice.
Dim sum, good dim sum over at the Wicked Spoon.
You got that right. Exactly. You got that right. So back to that McGregor and Mayweather fight. I don't know when it's going to happen, but it's funny. I saw Pacquiao was fighting, you know, some setup fight. It was just a couple of days ago, and it was one of those, you know, second round knockouts or some crap like that. And here's Pacquiao, staging a comeback. And you know, as soon as the McGregor fight's over with Mayweather, because Mayweather's going to get a decision. There's the only way that McGregor wins is if he knocks him out cold. Period.
I think if he hits him, he knocks him out cold.
I would agree. I would agree. So if he connects, he's done. But otherwise, you'll see Pacquiao Mayweather fight number two for $10 gazillion.
Nobody cares about that stuff anymore.
And no one's going to get hit.
I don't want to get into the world of what we did last year with electing all the stuff and everybody, but after all this fake news and his arm was hurt and you know what I mean? People are like, So it's so 216, man, and that was a bunch of nonsense. So I don't think we're going to see Pacquiao ever get in the ring with Mayweather again.
Yeah,
I think
will.
It's going to go on to circus stuff. I'm glad we're at the sports circus because, you
it's
know,
gonna
hey, Chris Brown's going to fight him. You know what I mean? Or Soldier Who or whatever. You know what I mean?
I don't know, Mr.
I got a beef with you, so let's get on this card, Sal. Let's figure it out.
Right.
Even brothers fight, you know. Come on.
Right.
What happened? What happened?
Well, look, what happened is you've got money, and more money. Big money grab is what's going on. And it's not whether it's 16, 15, or 2020. It's going to keep going and going and going. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, and we need more. It's like the Romans. We're going to have like 100 days off watching this stuff eventually, you know?
I don't know. You know, the big winner in all this is the pay-per-view, you know, and the cable companies behind it. And
I think sensationalism's the big winner.
Well, you know, even I think it was yesterday, the head of the MMA, he came on Colin Cowherd's show and said that he was willing to give $25 million for each fighter.
Wow.
Right.
Well, but the Dana problem White's is, no, he's no dummy, that Dana White.
Yeah, but you know what they want? The going rate for Mayweather is $100 million, believe it or not. $100 million. Are you kidding
me?
Well,
that's my whole point. Why is the guy willing to give up his legacy? What happens if Conor McGregor walks up, knocks the snot out of him, and now he's 49-1? Is it worth whatever? I mean, why does he need the money?
Well, he's retired, right? And the only way he's going to get back in the ring is with this fight. It's all propaganda BS. It's all the same crap. Same dog and pony show. But I had to talk about it because
here we are. And, you know, that guy, he's a great guy. You know, he's got some philanthropy in him. You'll see a lot of good things out of Floyd Mayweather. I just hope that they get their ducks in a row. And if they're going to fight, set a date, go beat the snot out of each other, at least enough for all of us to entertain ourselves and something exciting happen. Then I'll pay. But I don't want to just get duped again, you know?
Well, you can always go to the sports book at your favorite casino and watch it.
Well, true, right? And have a couple of hundred on whatever Sal says, you know?
Right.
Then go to them Knowles boys with some win money.
Yeah, well, anyway, you know, we've got a lot of great places for food here in town, and, you know, we'll be trying some other barbecue places, and I'll tell you what, though, I won't be trying it with the money that you're going to be spending on that pay-per-view fight.
I'll pay for it. That's what they didn't get me, man.
I know you'll pay for it. I can't pay for it. And, you know, they say that that was pretty funny. They say that there's you're saying there's a philanthropy piece of Floyd. Guess what? I don't see enough of it out there. I just don't see enough of it. All right. All right, we're going to be back in just a couple of minutes, and you're listening to the Sports Circus on Fox Sports Radio 1340. Okay, welcome back to the Sports Circus here on Fox Sports Radio 1340. I'm here with the human cannonball. There he is. And we have one MIA. If anybody has seen Sideshow Bob, dial 702-876-1340 and let everybody know that Sideshow Bob has been found. Because in the meantime, he is MIA.
If found, return to bus driver.
That's the guy. All right. So this segment is brought to you by Seattle Dan's Pizza, Pasta, and Grinders, located at 5115 West Sahara at Durango. Call in your lunch order or your dinner order at 702-946-6262. Get a 10% off by mentioning the Sports Circus. That's Seattle Dan's Pizza, Pasta, and Grinders. Good stuff, amigo.
Man, I like the way you say grinders. Now, is a grinder something different than like a hoagie or a hero?
It's the same.
Or
it's just a big sandwich. Anyway, so we're going to go to our student athlete spotlight and our special guest. We have today Super Bowl champion from the San Francisco 49ers, Toy Cook.
Wow.
Toy, are you there?
I am here. Thank you.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. It is really early out here on the left coast, but happy to be on.
Awesome. Well, we're here on the left coast, too, and at least the lights for the strip are on the drive here, so it looks kind of pretty.
I think you guys probably stay up all night.
I haven't slept in a year.
Yeah, well, staying up all night, yeah, sort of sometimes. I don't know. But, you know, Toy, we have to get here early in the morning, but we also have a student athlete that's going to join us in just a moment. His name is Calicio Howard, Jr., and he is a middle linebacker at Hoover High down in San Diego. Are you with me?
Yes, I am.
All right. So he has a lot of interesting ideas, thoughts, stories, questions, comments. We're just going to limit him to probably about, five or six of them. But anyway, we'd like for you to talk to him because, well, that's what we do here on the Sports Circus. All right, so let's bring him in. Let's bring in Calicio. Are you there, Calicio?
Yeah, I'm here. How y'all doing?
All right, we're doing well. Calicio, meet Toy, Super Bowl champion Toy.
Hello, Calicio.
How you doing, Toy?
I'm doing fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm doing good. I'm doing good. I have a couple questions for you. You know, I mean, after league life, you know, I heard you're like a really good businessman. So, and my major is business administration. So I wanted to know how that was for you after you got out of the league.
I was lucky as a kid that my dad worked in the entertainment business. Even when we were in Houston, he was a cameraman. So I went to a lot of Houston Astro games and Houston Oilers. They were the Oilers back then, games. And so I got to see professional athletes. And he also worked at the news station as a camera operator. So I got to see people working on television. So it wasn't really foreign to me. Then we moved out to Los Angeles, and he worked on shows like Entertainment Tonight and Soul Train and What's Happening, Carter Country, these TV shows. So as a kid, I was around in the high school I went to, Montclair Prep, Dick Clark, Tom Bosley from Happy Days, Robert Conrad, all these actors, Barry White, singer, all their kids went to school. So I just basically got to be around a bunch of successful people that motivated me. And then I was lucky enough to get a scholarship to Stanford. And that's, you know, I think that kind of prepared me for life after football.
That's a very impressive list of people you were surrounded by.
Yeah, I'm saying that's a good start, sir. Toy, yeah, good
no,
start.
Yeah, no, when you, yeah, no, when, well, like when you're talking to Barry White or, you know, I've talked to Tom Bosley or Robert Conrad or one of the, our running back, Tony Ashley, his dad, John Ashley, was the producer of A-Team. So, you know, as a kid, you know, this is from the time I was like 12 all the way through high school. So that's who I was talking to. So The expectations were high, but it wasn't so far-reaching.
That was the head of Happy Days, the Black Sheep Squadron, and what was the other one?
What you talking about, Tony?
Todd Bridges lived around the block for me in Canola Park, believe it or not, too. But yeah, it was kind of crazy. When you would go over to Barry White's house and there would be Don Cornelius, the creator of Soul Train, or one of the Jackson brothers.
Wow.
Man, that must have been a smooth conversation, those two talking to each other. Don Cornelius and Barry White. Well, listen.
Yeah, Don. I actually played baseball with a guy, B. John Watson, whose dad was Johnny Guitar Watson, a famous guitar player from the 70s and 80s. B. John ended up being head of player development for Dodgers, and then just recently the Arizona Diamondbacks. So, and then a kid that I played high school baseball with, Toy Lovello, is now the manager of the Arizona Diamondbacks. So, and his dad, Sam, was the producer of Hee Haw. So, yeah, it was
I
used to love that show.
And grinning, baby.
Love that show.
And he just passed away, Sam Lovello. So, rest in peace, Mr. Lovello. But, yeah, that's kind of who I grew up with. And playing baseball at Stanford, I played against Mark McGuire and Randy Johnson at SC. Torrey Lovello was at UCLA with Eric Carroll. So, just a bunch of them. I played with Jack McDowell, who won a Cy Young. Ruben Amaro, who was at Philadelphia Phillies, was my left fielder. It was just interesting. So when you're around those type of people, and that's what I would suggest is when you get to college, hang out with as many people as you can, and that will help you, define where you want to go.
God. Isn't that crazy? I mean, Toy,
that is crazy.
Toy, for you,
that's a lot of people I don't know because I'm young.
He's like the Forrest Gump of champions.
Well, for Toy to step onto the NFL field and excel at the highest level there, I mean, it's kind of old hat for you because you kind of grew up with this. You've been in the rodeo before you even got to the NFL anyway.
Even going to Stanford, I always said that, once again, I was blessed. So as a kid, even when I was, from 7 to 12, I was going to Astro games and Houston Oilers training camp. So I was seeing guys like Dan Pastorini, Earl Campbell.
Billy White Shoes Johnson.
J.R. Richards and Faisal Sedanio. So
Faisal Sedanio, man, you are going back.
Was my favorite player, yeah. And then we come out to L.A., and he's doing Dodger games. So I get to see Steve Garvey and Ron Say and Billy Russell, who I just played golf with.
All right. That was Davey Lopes and Rick Mundy were on that team, too.
That's right. Yep. And Dusty Baker. And,
right.
That was
Tommy's team.
That was Tommy's team, Reggie Smith.
Yeah.
So I got to see those guys. And then, when you go to college, do you know where you're going to college yet?
Either Redlands University, Whittier University, or Laverne. Really haven't made a decision yet.
I know that the Redlands, they got a great television film program. So we're for me going to Stanford, I got to practice like John Elway would come back and throw, and Jim Plunkett would come and throw, and receivers that played in the league or played for the Niners, I was covering guys that had been in the league 5, 6, 7 years. So then I had Ronnie Lott and Eric Wright and Dana McLemore telling me, Ronnie said, hey, you can play in the league just watching me cover. So, to have Ronnie Lott tell you that you can play, I always say, the power of words is very important. The fact that he told me that I could play and I had, covered these guys, I knew that I could play in the league. And knowing is half the battle, right? It's not most of the battle. So going into the league, I knew I was supposed to be in the league, so it was not that big of a deal.
It just seemed to be a natural progression for you, I would assume.
Yeah. No, once again, when you're covering guys that have been in the league, and I'm like, I was all over them.
And, you know, then you have guys that are in the league that are Pro Bowlers, like Ronnie Lott, Hall of Famer, future Hall of Famer anyway, or he is a Hall of Famer, telling you that you can play, you know, that just, you know, that's just, that's icing on the cake. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. You know, I, at the time, you know, I was a 3-year starter in both sports. So I went from playing 8-man football. I tell people this. I didn't play football until I was 15, but I played baseball since I was 7. And my first 2 years in high school, sophomore and junior year, we played 8-man football. Then my senior year, we went to 11-man football, and they somehow found me down in Montclair Prep in Van Nuys. And because I played baseball, you know, Stanford was, like, really ahead of its time in two-sport athletes and said, hey, come play. You can play baseball, too. And so I went up there, played as a freshman, and then started as a sophomore in both sports. We ended up winning the College World Series my senior year. And I get drafted by the Twins and the Saints, and I decided to go play for the Saints. Because in baseball, football, you'll know in 5 weeks either you're going to be on the team or you're not. Where in, you know, baseball, I could still probably be in the minor leagues at 52.
You know,
even though I know I would have made it because I played against Eric Carlson, Todd Hill, and Torrey and Odubi McDowell, and Barry Bonds that was at Arizona State. So I could have played baseball too, but football is my first love.
Well, you can still play baseball now. Hell, Julio Franco's still out there at 56, man, swinging a bat, right?
Yeah, yeah. And what you call it? Manny Manram just went to Japan.
I know. Go, because that's what Manny does, right?
He's a pro. That's a real pro.
You know what? I love the fact that Manny will do whatever he wants to do. And if he thinks that he can play, let him play. Let him show the world he can play. I mean, Ricky Henderson was stealing bases until he was 50.
I was going to say Ricky Henderson is probably still playing. I mean, he was playing through his 40s.
Right, right. Ricky's out there. He's probably still playing somewhere. He's probably just playing in a league where nobody knows his name. That's all.
Yeah, except for Ricky.
Yeah, right, exactly. I saw a lot of that. I played in a league in Mexico, and there was a lot of ex-ball players from the bigs that were playing in there because they just loved the game, and they didn't want any notoriety. They just wanted to play and not be bothered.
Yeah. No, I call those, you know, like, those are real professionals. You know, like, when you play that long and you stay in it, probably, you know, the one mistake that I said, I should have gone into coaching right after playing because I'm a natural coach and all my friends are coaching. That is probably what I should have done, but if I did that, I probably wouldn't be married. And I definitely wouldn't be around my kids because being a coach, you have to, you know, you leave before the kids wake up and you come home, they're asleep. So.
Right. You'll be living with your job, and that's about it. That's all right. So, oh, by the way, Toy, I got to tell you, I had a conversation with Jim Everett, and I told Jim what you said about he would have passed for $50,000 if you weren't out there swatting balls down and stealing them from him. Of course, he got a big chuckle out of it. He said, you know, you're probably right. He said, me and a lot of other guys.
Well, the way the rules are set up now, where, you know, it's tough enough to compete against Aaron Rodgers and Tom Brady and Drew Brees and Phillip Rivers. And then it can be 3rd and 14 and you're on one side of the field. They throw the ball over on the side of where, you know, they try to go for a bomb. It's 3rd and 15. They don't get it. And then they get an illegal hands to the face or an illegal hold, which is a 5-yard penalty. And that's an automatic first down. Well, if you continue to give, like I said, Tom Brady, Ben Roethlisberger, you know, any of the guys that are left, Russell Wilson, any of the guys left in the playoffs, you give them multiple opportunities, you're going to get scorched.
Right.
Right. And so I just think about, man, could you imagine if John Elway and Chris, Jim Everett and Chris Miller and Steve Young and Joe Montana, if all those guys, Dan Marino, I mean, do you want to give those guys the same amount of opportunities to score? They would have broke every record book. So I call this era, this is, to me, is the steroid era for football.
Right. You know, we see a lot of that in, well, we see a lot of that in baseball, of course. Right?
I perked up, Sal. I'm like, wow.
But, you know, we, it's kind of like watching the NBA. You see a watered down version of basketball now, just in my opinion. And I don't see the defense played. You know, I talked to Gary Payton about, oh, six, 7 months ago, and we were talking about what the Warriors were doing with all their wins and their long win streaks. And Gary said, listen, man, there is no way that that team would be scoring 110, 115 points a game in our era. He said they'd be scoring maybe in the mid-90s. You know, the defense was very different, just like what you're talking about. The games were called very different, too. Hell, even hockey's the same way. You know, Colicchio is a middle linebacker.
Yes.
How big are you?
I'm about 5'11", 275 pounds.
Did you say 275?
275.
Oh, man.
He's as big as me, Sal.
I know.
That's you're a cannonball.
Yeah, okay. And wait, and you're a middle linebacker?
Yes, I'm a middle linebacker.
Wow, that's a... I mean, usually someone like you in high school would be like a nose tackle, right? So you must be able to run if you got they got you playing middle linebacker. And didn't who what famous NFL player went to Hoover? Was that Reggie Bush or was it Marcus Allen?
It was Marcus Allen. It was Marcus Allen. Reggie Bush went to Helix.
Yeah, Marcus Allen went to Hoover, right?
Yeah,
yeah. So that's pretty impressive. At 275, you got to be able to run. You got to be able to cover. I played with a guy, Sam Mills. If you ever go to Carolina Panthers, mm-hmm. there's a statue of Sam Mills, the late, great Sam Mills. Sam was only 5'9", 225. But him, Ricky Jackson, who's the first Hall of Fame member from the Saints, Pat Swilling, and Von Johnson were voted the greatest linebacker unit in the NFL ahead of the Lawrence Taylor.
Those guys can hit too. Man, can they hit. And they were fast.
I was lucky. I played, 7 years in New Orleans with those guys. And then Ricky and I went straight from Saints to the Niners. And so I played 9 years at Ricky Jackson, Hall of Fame outside linebacker. Played with Kenny Norton was on that team. He's the defensive coordinator for the Raiders now. Played with Kevin Green in Carolina, outside linebacker, who also just went into the Hall of Fame. So I always like to say I know a little bit something about what it takes to be a pretty good linebacker, which is, running and hitting, basically.
That's ridiculous. That lineup of players that you have played with, and it's nuts. It's nuts.
Yeah, no, listen, like I said, Gary Kubiak, who just, retired from the Denver Broncos, he was our offensive quarterback coach when I was at the Niners and we won the Super Bowl and we beat the Chargers, which was the last time they were. I think we were 18.5-point favorites. They're talking about their 16-point favorites.
And you guys still covered. It was 49-26, wasn't it?
That's right. Yeah, we covered. We covered right. We covered in the first quarter. We were up 21-0. I said we scored 3 touchdowns before Kathy Lee had got done singing the national anthem.
That's funny.
Yeah, no, so it was, Mike Shanahan was our offensive coordinator. Bill Musgrave, who's the offensive coordinator for the Raiders, was our third-string quarterback. Ed McCaffrey was our fourth receiver.
That's nuts. Again.
Yeah, no, it was Anthony Lynn came the next year as a running back, and then he went to Denver and got 2 more rings. He's now the head coach of San Diego Chargers. He was on the team, so yeah, it was a pretty special team. Our defensive back coach Tom Homo is now the athletic director at BYU. So it was a pretty special group. But John McVay was our general manager, or executive, I should say. And, his son now is our grandson, Sean McVay, is the
head coach of the Rams. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I've been like kind of like Forrest Gump, with my life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially with the lineup of people you met and the things you do, man. Definitely A1 Forrest Gump in life.
Yeah. Well, and here's the good news is,
you can achieve the same thing. I mean, I tell, you know, people that are that want to go in the league, that, you know, to get in the league, you only there's three things that you really have to do. One is to always be on time, never be late, right? Because if you're like what happened with Odell Beckham,
yeah,
trust me, was he going down to Miami, being on the boat on a Monday? Because typically back in the day, we had on a Monday, Tuesday. Tuesdays were our day off. We would go play golf. You know, we didn't have the means to jump on a jet and go somewhere. Even though Lawrence Taylor used to come on his day off and come play golf with Ricky Jackson. Those guys were like bet crazy money because they're golf fanatics. But we would play golf. But what happens in college and in pros, on say on a Tuesday or Wednesday, you have a meeting and you're 5 minutes late or even 1 minute late. And then you play in the game on, you know, Saturday or Sunday and you make a mistake. They'll rewind all the way back to that Wednesday or Tuesday and say you didn't make the play because you were late. And you want to just take that off the table of things that they can point out. So always be on time. Two, don't stay out of trouble, right? Don't be that guy, right? Half of your competitors, and we say this, like when you go to training camp, right, or you read about these guys that get in trouble, that's your competition. So if you stay out of trouble, don't be that guy, and be on time, you will get rid of 50% of your competition because all you have to do is look around the league. Guys can't be on time. Right. They get in trouble. You know, Jerry Porter getting, you know, as a coach, getting in a fight with a bouncer outside, you know, after a game. You know, I mean, some guys get multiple opportunities to play and don't get in trouble. But if you're, like, on that kind of bubble, trust me, there's going to be another guy that's going to be there to take your place. So, you know, if you can just do that, you're going to be way ahead of the game.
All right. Don't stay out of trouble and don't be late.
Don't be late. Stay out of trouble. Don't be that guy.
That guy. That guy is one that gets in trouble, and the last thing you want to do is end up in trouble and not have an opportunity to get on the field and show your skills. Right? Play the game that you love.
And be coachable. Be humble. Those are good traits.
Yeah, I mean, listen, and first of all, in the pros, more so than in college, which is changing in college, Dom Capers, who is now the defensive coordinator for Green Bay Packers, he was my first DB coach at the Saints for 5 years. And then my next one was Jim Mora. People say junior, but he's not. He's the head coach at UCLA now. He was my second coach, DB coach. My third coach was Tom Homo, who ended up being the head coach at Cal Berkeley. Now he's AD at BYU. But I said, if you coach me, you're going to be a head coach. I'm going to make you the head coach territory, right? The only one, George Katavlos, is the only one that didn't. He's still coaching in Carolina. But the whole idea is that in the pros, you spend a lot of time in those meeting rooms and with the coaches. So the coaches spend a lot of time with you. So when you see these guys going to the combine and coaches are meeting with them, you know, the coaches have to decide, like, is this a guy that I want to spend a lot of time with? And most of the coaches, and not all of the coaches, they want guys that are going to show up to work, that are not going to be problems, right? Because, look, they're, in the NFL, you're being hired to be fired. So they want to have the most reliable people. I used to tease our coaches in San Francisco. I said we had the most well-rested coaches in the world. They slept like babies because what are you going to worry about when you have Steve Young, Jerry Rice, John Taylor, Brent Jones, Ricky Waters, Ed McCaffrey, Nate Singleton, you know, and then on the defensive side, especially us, it was me, Dion, Eric Davis, who you see on NFL Network, and now I think he's on ESPN, Tim McDonald, who was coaching in Buffalo. His son, TJ, plays for the Rams. Merton Hanks, who's given out fines in the NFL. And Dana Hall. So T-Mac, Merton Hanks, Dion, me, and Eric Davis. So ask Jim Everett what it was like trying to play against us, right? So as a defensive back coach, you didn't have to worry. All you had to do was throw the playbook and leave the room.
That's funny.
Right. And then on also on that team was Richard Dent, Charles Mann, Ricky Jackson, oh my God, Ken Norton, Tim Harris. I mean, it was like an all-star team.
It's not even fair. All right, it's ridiculous.
No, it wasn't. It's like, if you go look at that roster, it's the greatest roster in Super Bowl history. It's not even, I mean, Richard Dent, Charles Mann, Tim Harris. Right.
It was like 4,000 sacks between those guys.
Dana Stubblefield was on that team.
Yeah, very scary.
Bryant Young was a rookie. Yeah, no, it was fun to play.
Well, hell, all you needed was Mike Singletary. You'd add the whole thing.
We would add the whole crew.
Well, Calicio, we're gonna wrap this segment up here. Do you have any final words for Toy?
I just want to thank him for the opportunity, man, and thank all you guys for the opportunity for having me on. And then, you know, I would like to get in contact with Troy a little bit more, you know, chop it up. We can talk about things, you know. I'm about to go off to college, so I wanted to know, like, how it would be up there in college. Like, I've never played college ball. I played high school football for 4 years on varsity. So I just want to know, is the next level as big as they say it is?
Yeah, I mean, it is, but it isn't. It's still football. You still got to go tackle. Right. The key is to make the whole idea is, I always said this, you might get me in the first quarter, but you're not going to get me in the fourth quarter. Right. So when the game is on the line, I wasn't that guy. I didn't get beat. Right. Like, you see all those touchdowns Jerry Rice scored.
Yeah.
You know, see, when you see that film, like, see how many times you see number 41 on there. Like, you ain't seeing me. So the whole idea is, listen, coaches do a good job of telling you what to do, and they put you in the right place. What happens is players aren't where they're supposed to be. 75% of the time, if you do what the coaches tell you, you're going to be all right. And so the key is not to make the same mistake over. And I was listening to this guy, Cockrell, who's a corner for Pittsburgh, and he was talking about Coach Lake, which was Carnell Lake. Carnell Lake went to UCLA, and he is a year behind me because he came out, but he played for Pittsburgh Steelers. Anyway, he's coaching, and one of the things he kept telling was, like, pros do not make the same mistake twice, right? And that's the key. The key is, once again, be on time for everything, school, for weightlifting, for anything that the coaches are going to be there, even just for yourself. Be on time. And just do what they tell you to do. Stay out of trouble, and everything will work out. You got to stay healthy, too, you know, because we say you can't make the club in the tub. but I know that's a lot, but really, it's all the same. And you'll see. When you first get there, it's going to look like everyone's moving at 100 miles an hour. But as you continue to play, the game will slow down. I call it the Neo, whatever that movie's called.
Matrix.
It slows down to a Matrix level as you get older. So you'll laugh at by the time you're a junior, you know, you'll see how much you'll be like, oh my God, I can't believe it. If I'd have known this stuff in high school, I'd have really been killing people. But it's just a progression. So take your time. And the other part is enjoy it. Have fun.
So, Toy, who do you have in the Super Bowl? Who's going to be there? Who's going to win?
I have the Patriots. I just find it hard to believe, and believe it or not, it might. Well, it's either Green Bay or Dallas. I just don't know if Green Bay's defense can hold up, which we're going to find out, you know, today, tomorrow, whichever, whenever they play.
Right.
But I got the Patriots because I think Patricia, the defensive coordinator for the Patriots, even though they give up a lot of yards, they don't give up touchdowns. And I really like their secondary, Malcolm Butler, the kid that was – now you want to talk about that. Here's a player that went to, like, Alabama State. I mean, he wasn't even drafted.
He wasn't even on the map.
He wasn't even on the map. And they had a – what they call is they invite kids to come to camp. So it's an undrafted free agent camp that he came to, not even with the other players.
Right.
And they decided to keep him and then he makes the greatest play, and now he's like a Pro Bowler, right? I mean, that to me, that like that's a great story. See, and somebody was saying like, hey, you know, D1, this new league that's coming out that might affect, you know, the smaller schools, because now versus going to a smaller school, you can go play in this new league and get paid. And what does that do for, like, you know, the D1? I go, half the people in the NFL are not D1. They're not even five-star recruits, right? That's why a lot of it's luck. A lot of it's staying out of trouble. A lot of it's just want to. You got to want to. And that's, I wanted to, right? You know, I wanted to. I didn't like going to school. I went to Stanford, but the only reason I went to this class was so I could stay eligible so I could play, because I went to Stanford to play, to go to the pros. That was, they still laugh about that. I didn't go to Stanford. I mean, it was great, but my main objective was it was a step to go to the pros. And that's all I wanted to do. And I had a plan, and that plan was to stay eligible and play. And it worked out. And everyone that you see in the pros, they had their own plan. And even if you don't make it to the pros, that's the best thing about sports. You don't have to make it to the pros. You could be a coach. You could be an agent. You could be a trainer. Even better, you could be an owner, right? So the business of sports, and sports, especially football, is the only thing that's recession-proof. You know how, like, when the economy goes down?
Yeah.
You see these players? Do their salaries go down? Salaries going up, right? Coaches are making more. Players are making more. You know, teams are making more. So our economy could be going down to the depths of hell, but yet football and salaries and sports salaries continue to go up.
Right. They just keep making more and more money, right?
That's right. And that's why I would advise to stay in the business of sport. Even if you're not a player, you could be a coach. Right, and that's a great business.
Right,
even though you're going to be away from your family. But
on that note, that's a lot of information. And Toy, you're an encyclopedia. You're the Google of knowledge for sports, as we could see that. I appreciate you coming on.
Yeah, every once in a while, but thank you.
Appreciate you coming on. Also appreciate Calicio taking the time. You both getting up at the crack of dawn, hell before the sun's even up, start making phone calls into here. And we loved having you. We'd like to have you both again.
Yeah, thank you. Anytime. Let me know. You can give my email address to Calicio.
Absolutely. I'll make sure I forward that.
You've been a great guest. I mean, we have amazing people on this show, but you were awesome today. Thank you for being on.
Hey, thanks for having me, guys, and Happy New Year.
All right, you too, guys. So that was one heck of a guest, wasn't it?
Wow. I think I need a smoke and a shower. Wow. That guy knows his stuff.
Yeah, well, he's been around the block. I mean, this guy really knows his stuff. I mean, he's played with the best of the best, whether it was baseball or football. Just an incredible guest, but an incredible human.
It wasn't even braggadocious. I mean, Dean said, it ain't bragging if you can do it. So obviously, he knew where he was, who he did it with, and what they're doing today. So...
Well, since he was a kid.
That's important stuff to this guy. It's obvious he's made of being a champion. So,
since he was a kid, he's been doing this.
Thanks for being on.
Wow. That's crazy. So, we only have a couple of minutes, real quick. Let's go over our picks for today and tomorrow. We have Seattle at Atlanta, and Seattle is +5. What do you think?
Why would you lead with the plus unless you're favoring Seattle?
Well, of course. I'm going with Seattle. I got Seattle winning the Super Bowl. It doesn't matter to me.
You can't come out and say it's -5. I'm taking the dog. You got to lead with Seattle +5.
I'm leading. Get over it.
Well, 5's an odd number. Let's face it. They want to give every fan a reason to bet. So I think 5's a solid number.
All right. New England is -16 at home against Houston.
Easy winner.
New England. I think it's New England.
Let a little air out of the ball, will you?
New England, I think New England wins that game 41-0. They won 27-0 last time. These are all four of these are rematches, by the way.
Laydowns.
Right? And so Pittsburgh is at Kansas City. Kansas City's -1.5.
Kansas City's a toss-up. I mean, Pittsburgh could come and really bring the heat today.
Pittsburgh by 10 points.
Yeah, they could
Pittsburgh
do it
by
today.
10. All they got to do is win. I think they win by 10. Kansas City don't have the offense to stay with them. I can't see it. And, of course, we have Green Bay at Dallas, and I don't know, guys.
Dallas wins, and Dak we trust, right?
You know, I'm a little worried about the Packers stacking 8 guys in the box, forcing Prescott to throw the ball, because they're going to stop the run. They're going to do everything they can to stop Elliott and Prescott. They're going to force Prescott to stay in the pocket, not roll out, because you don't want him running because he's a big guy. He's just like, Cam Newton's a big guy.
You took it out of my mouth. I think he's going to give that Cam Newton performance today. I think he's going to shock and awe. He might even do some run-ins. You know, this guy's going to score a couple of times, pass, run. I don't know. He might even kick a field goal.
I'm giving it to Dallas. I don't think they're going to cover, though.
Cover. I listen to you, Sal. You've tamed me with your victories. So.
81%.
Yes, sir.
I'm at 81.2%. 81.2 for the entire year.
Listen to this guy. He'll make you some money.
And that's against the line.
Even though you don't believe him. Yeah,
that's against the line. It's ridiculous.
It is. It is.
It really is. I don't know, man, but you know,
I got a crazy sports story. I mean, I got a story. How fast
well,
we
you're
got.
Gonna have you're gonna have to save it for next week because I don't think we have time here.
Well, I'll make it easy. The guy threw some blood pudding at some Yorkshire stuff, and he won over in England. It's a 100-year-old event. Next week we'll talk more.
Right. Well, remember, this show is brought to you by the American Business Trust Company, specializing in new growth companies, investment capital, etc. Reach them at 657-600-1876. Also, again, special thanks to my friends over at The Franchise. At AM 830 KLAA, you can catch me as Sal the Bookmaker, Monday through Friday, 10 p.m. Until next week, Human Cannonball, have yourself a great one.
I absolutely will. Folks, go out there and focus and stay out of trouble and be on time.
You've been listening to The Sports Circus on Fox Sports 1340.
I know what the big deal about Cracker Jack is. Did you ever go and buy a pack of Cracker Jack thinking you'd get a prize and find no prize in the box? Here's the pitch. That might not sound important to some people, but when you're a little kid, especially from humble origin, and they cheat you out of a prize, there's a bouncing ball. Second baseman has the Barbary over to first. It's hard to think in laudatory terms of the product.
I take it there was an occasional box of Cracker Jacks that found no prizes for the little Harry Carey many years ago.
You got that right. And boy, when a box of Cracker Jack to me meant a lot of money. Here's a pitch, bounce foul. That's the most asinine marketing I've ever heard of. One ball, one strike. These guys say, well, you sing about Cracker Jack. I said that I only sing it because it's in the song. Here's a pitch, foul back. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised, even to this day, some youngsters who buy a box of Cracker Jack don't find a prize in the box. One ball, two strikes, two out. Well, if you're going to talk about our congressman being crooked, here's a pitch foul out of play. Why not talk about commercial products that don't do what they represent to do? High pop fly. That one be a home run in a phone booth. Can't beat fun at the old ballpark, friends.
There's a drive way back. It might be. It could be. And it is.
Holy cow.
This crowd is wild.
Can your IRA stand up to the next financial crisis that our top economists are saying is at our doorsteps? By allocating a percentage of your IRA into physical gold and silver with a tax-free rollover, you can diversify and safeguard your holdings from turbulent markets and economic downturns by putting your IRA back on the gold standard. Find out how to safeguard your assets with a tax-free rollover with a Genesis Gold IRA, the only IRA that can hold physical precious metals. Call now for your free gold and silver report. Protect your IRA today with one simple phone call and learn how to qualify for up to $10,000 in free silver. Call Genesis Gold Group, empowering faith-driven stewardship. 800-932-5517. 800-932-5517. 800-932-5517. That's 800-932-5517.